So in this group of lectures, we're going to talk about the endocrine, skeletal, and muscular systems. We'll start with the endocrine system. Of all the body systems, this is probably the least well understood. The skeletal system, the muscular system, we know the parts, we basically know how those work. Endocrine, we understand primarily how it works, but as you're going to see, the endocrine system is able to affect a lot of different tissues and a lot of different systems, and we're still figuring out some of those complexities. So the endocrine system is a system that produces hormones that control and coordinate chemical reactions throughout the body. So along with the nervous system, endocrine system is going to be involved in body control. When I say that you control chemical reactions, it could be that you stop them completely, you start them, or just speed up or slow them down. There's a lot of fine-tuned control involved with the endocrine system. The endocrine system is going to consist of a series of glands, and each produces one or more hormones. The endocrine system can cause two kinds of changes. It can cause quick short-term changes or permanent long-term changes. Example of quick short-term change would be the epinephrine response. Many of you know this as adrenaline. This is your fight or flight response. This is when you get an immediate crazy burst of energy that allows you to run away from a scary situation. Sometimes you hear about a little lady picking up a car off of her grandchild or something like that. Epinephrine is the hormone that gives you this crazy kind of immediate energy. If you've ever been in a car accident or some really stressful situation, you've probably experienced this. Afterwards, you're pretty shaky and it takes you a while to sort of relax from this experience. Norepinephrine is just the opposite of epinephrine. This is what turns off this response. Permanent long-term changes, think about estrogen and testosterone. These are the hormones that do many things, but during puberty, they are what help create secondary sexual characteristics. So what makes you physically look like male or female comes from these permanent long-term changes. These teeny chemicals can be very powerful. And I think it's interesting to look and see that they're just not that different. Here we have testosterone and estrogen. And notice they have similar ring structures and just a few differences in their attached R groups. And I think it's truly amazing that just a few differences in atoms on this molecule are the difference between being a man and being a woman. So a little bit more about hormones. Hormones are complex macromolecules that act as chemical messengers. Hormones have a specific shape that allows them to have a very specific effect on certain cells called target cells. Just like we've seen over and over again in human biology and biology in general, the shape leads to the specific function. Some hormones are proteins and some are lipids. Hormones are produced by glands, and unlike most systems, the glands can be very far away from the target cells. Most systems, the organs involved are all right next to each other, but that's not necessarily the case in the endocrine system. So you could be producing a hormone up in your brain that's affecting a completely different part of your body. They're going to use the bloodstream to move to the target cells. So the hormones are going to be produced by the gland, secreted into the circulatory system, and then move through the body to the target cells. Once they reach the cell, they're going to diffuse in or use signal transduction. The lipids are going to be able to diffuse into the cell, and typically the protein-based hormones will use signal transduction. Remember, signal transduction is when a protein attaches to a membrane protein and changes its shape and causes a series of reactions inside the cell. Glands are groups of cells or organs that secrete hormones. There are some glands that are dedicated entirely to producing hormones, and then there are actually other organs that are part of other systems. The pancreas, for example, produces digestive enzymes for the digestive system, and it also produces hormones. So some are dedicated just to the endocrine system. Others will be cells within a larger organ that has other functions as well. Your textbook goes into more details about the different kinds of glands. I don't want you to necessarily memorize the different names. I'll let you do that in anatomy and physiology class, but here are a few examples. The thyroid secretes hormones that stimulate metabolism. Remember, metabolism is just a sum of all the chemical reactions going on in your body. So if you produce more hormone from your thyroid, you will do more chemical reactions per hour. There are diseases associated with the thyroid and the hormones that it produces. If it produces too much of its hormone, you're going to get something called hyperthyroidism. People with this disease just can't sit still, they can't sleep well, their body's sort of buzzing and working too fast. Their metabolism is always going faster than it needs to. A little bit more common is hypothyroidism. Hypo, Latin root, means under. This is that you are not producing enough of your thyroid hormone. These people don't have a lot of energy, even though they're eating or exercising. They just don't have any energy. There's a variety of things that can cause this. There can be a genetic component. Cancer of the thyroid can cause hyperthyroidism or hypothyroidism. And it is something that once you're diagnosed, you can treat. I mentioned estrogen and testosterone earlier, but I just wanted to point out that there are a number of different glands involved in producing a variety of hormones that determine whether you're male or female. So your balance of estrogen and testosterone is what's going to largely determine whether you're male or female, but there are additional glands that are going to produce additional hormones that will also influence male and female characteristics. Often one gland will produce a hormone simply that stimulates another gland to produce another hormone. Remember, a gland produces hormones that go to target cells. The target cells might just be in another gland, and that's very common. And it's a sort of cascade way to maintain a very careful control in the body. We'll see an example of this in a minute when I talk about a positive feedback loop. The hypothalamus can trigger the pituitary gland, and the pituitary gland then produces additional hormones. So we've got this cascade effect.